Jack stands in the dark on the landing of the old house and looks at his feet. He is outside the last of three doors, the one that is underlined with flickering light. He doesn't move. He stares down at the twin crescents of light reflecting on the toes of his shoes. He looks at the thin highlights along the edges of the bare floorboards and at the pattern of the grain in the wood in the pale puddle of light that leaks under the door. He has been here for minutes, his hand on the door handle, debating whether or not to go in. Common sense insists that he must not, because there is no way of knowing what might be inside. But curiosity insists the opposite, for the same reason. And Jack is a curious boy. So he holds a breath behind clamped lips, turns the handle and goes in. And there they are, 12 of them, sat around a big circular wooden table and looking at him as the door creaks loudly to announce his arrival. It takes him a moment to see them properly. The room is only dimly lit by candles, but after the darkness outside it still seems bright, and it takes his eyes some time to adjust. When they do, and the indistinct figures settle into focus, it is the pale man furthest from Jack, whom he notices first. He is a small man, soberly dressed in a dark suit that is neatly tailored and primly buttoned, a crisp white shirt with a wing collar, a plain, dark tie. His hair is short and well-behaved. His posture is excellent. He is neat and tidy and quiet. There is nothing about him, his slightly old-fashioned clothes aside, to mark him out as extraordinary, and yet he exudes a quiet authority that draws Jack's eye. His face is lit from below by the candle on the table in front of him, giving it that torch under the chin spooky effect. But his measured smile is reassuring.
"You're late," says one of the others, one of the women over to the right, her voice scratchy and irritated.
"We're all late," says another. Jack doesn't understand what she means, but he's grateful that she sounds friendly. Looks it too when he turns his head to see. She has an attractive smile that she must have used a lot, judging by the laughter lines on her face. And she watches Jack with wry amusement, her dark eyes glinting in the candlelight, short silver-grey hair shining. "Come on in then," she says, raising an arm and beckoning with long fingers, tickling at the air. "No skulking in the dark. Over here where we can see you." Her voice is a soft and lovely thing, round and warm, with a sweet tang of teasing laughter. Jack does as he is told and steps three sleepwalking paces into the room as the door creaks shut behind him.